with you about how to enforce open standards. And as you probably know it, that is one of the issues, especially the accessibility to documents, or in the future, or to be exact, accessibility to documents that were written in the past. Sometimes this issue is actually a feature. In there are cases you probably don't want your documents to be readable in the future. This might be one of the cases. But this case is usually a bug, not a feature. And for most documents, we actually want them to be readable. This is an article from Scientific American, where the author does a follow-up to another article he wrote. And here he talks about the world situation is especially bizarre. Microsoft is a curator of the world's most common word processing format, which is, for our sense, is true. You think they feel some obligation to maintain its ability to open its own documents, no matter how old. This is especially true for relatively very old formats, even if we talked about something 20 years ago, 15 years ago, which is very problematic. But to a certain degree, it's also true for relatively recent formats. This is a page from Microsoft support website for Office, where it talks about what doesn't work when you try to open Word 2010 documents in Office 2007. Okay, so some feature doesn't work. It's okay to have numbers converted between different numbering systems, like alphabet in different languages to numbers and stuff like that. It's not pleasant, but you don't lose content. But in some features, they actually write removed, which means what? You lose the content. If you save it, you save it without the content. What happens when you reopen it in a later version? There's some very weird effects about it. And I'm still not talking about interoperability with other programs. This is only programs by Microsoft. So one of the common problem in both cases about this is that, at least for Microsoft, there's almost one-to-one ratio between Microsoft Office version and the document format. For a lot of time, we had each version created new format for the binaries. It added new features, and you must use that version in order to open the binaries. Obviously, creating backward compatibility issues and forward compatibility issues or security issues. And our obvious goal is to have one standard to rule them all, or actually to separate the idea of the software from the standard. And this is just a short list of available Office suites or word processing options. We have two from Microsoft, one for offline, one for online. Google Docs, LibreOffice, WPS Office, OnlyOffice, something from Apple I never saw. OnlyOffice WordPerfect, which used to be very active 2 decades ago, but it's alive, I found out. Office Suite and CalibreOffice. But when we're talking about standards, there is an issue of adaptation and the level of adaptation. Some countries say that ODF is allowed, which means they actually recognize the standard exists, although obviously it's already approved by ISO and other standardization organizations. But allowed means like, we know it exists, you can use it, we wouldn't say you can't, but that's it. You don't have you're not required to do that. In some cases, it doesn't even mean you must have the ability to read it. So some governments, if you send them ODF, they can say, well, I don't have to support it, it's not a requirement for me, so send it to me in a different format. So allow is usually nice to have. Then we're talking about some government which says must be able to read. So if this, a civilian or a company sends them a document in ODF format, they at least must be able to read. They don't have to send a reply back in that format, but that's a good case. In some other governments, it's a recommended standard or recommended solution, but for a lot of people, when you think of day-to-day, when someone says to you, this is a recommended restaurant, you think, okay, I should do that. With a lot of governments, recommended is just another way to say nice to have, but it's a little bit more than must be able to read. In some cases, governments have some levels for recommended, like just recommended, highly recommended, and some different phrasing I encountered, which is sometimes weird because you might have only two solutions, both of them are recommended, so what's the point of adding the adjective? In other countries, there's an issue, is it the only standard, or there's more than one option? Like some countries must be able to read ODF and OOXML, but there's no guidelines about what is the default when they send information or create new data. And this is also an important issue. Is there a default to stuff? Like one government might say, well, our default is ODF. If you have a specific use, we might allow OOXML, or when we go to a procurement process, it must support both of them, but we don't care what's the default. It's very delicate issues of policy, but their effect in real life is important. You define the guidelines, but some IT guy would actually use that for his own benefit to do what is easier or much more preferable in his opinion. And sometimes the language is very important because it narrows his options or forcing to apply the policy. In some countries, there is a talk about PDF. In most cases, PDF-A. Is it possible? Is it possible in general? Can the government say, well, I'm sending all my documents in PDF and you shouldn't care with which program they created it? Does it mean there is no editable versions of the documents? What happens when you want to exchange document and actually have comments or feedback from someone else in the document, not just an email that says, well, this is my opinion about the subject? Some government says, well, you must use ODF, and you can or allowed to use PDF for non-editable documents. For example, if you want a press release, that's usually non-editable, so okay, send it in PDF, that's fine. If you want a working document or something to be shared with some others, you must use ODF. And of course, usually the highest level, unless some lawyer added some interesting tricks into the language, required or must is the best level. Notice that in some cases there are more than one issue for required or must, and then there's another way to look. So in some cases you see there's must in a few options, which is actually means it's, let's say, allowed or recommended, and that's taken out of context. A quick survey of what countries have ODF as a mandatory standard. It sums up to four countries, which is very weird. It terrorizes his eyes from the computer, so you might correct me during the presentation. But from what I found, there's only four countries which only have ODF as mandatory. There's no mentioning about OOXML, and they might use PDF, but only for not editable. So we are talking about Denmark, Malaysia, Portugal, and Venezuela. For Venezuela, I didn't find the year it was announced. And there is some other country, yes?
I mean, it's mentioned as mandatory, but no one in those countries respects the law.
Okay, so that's...
That's
right. I probably have to amend that slide.
Actually,
a policy which is enforced and not only written.
It's also Italy in 2013 mentioned ODF as a preferred format, mm-hmm. but everyone is ignoring it at all, completely.
So preferred is one of the languages I found for recommended, but there's a
it's very political.
Preferred, yes, exactly. Between preferred and must or mandatory, whatever phrasing. So here you see, just a second, here you see the phrasing sounds completely different to our ears. Like we said, yes, it's preferred, it's perfect, we reach our goal.
And to no, it's a tragedy preferred.
I know. So to our ears it might sound great, just a second. And when the policy, the guy that actually has to fulfill the policy, to him it sounds completely different. You had a question.
Yeah, just a comment on that. Yes. They had a huge debate back then, but they ended up with a dual OEF, OOXML recommendation, so it really means nothing.
Okay, I didn't know it.
And in addition, what is a pity in all of this is that there's no rationale behind the decision. So it's no one, and this is very bad because there's no education about what a standard format is and the value of a standard format. So it's a kind of, you should use that, but for no reason. So this, of course, to people says,
it's hard to replicate.
Yeah, I can use the one that I prefer because if there's no reason for using that one, then I can use whatever I want.
Requested ODF as the ethical office format. Nevertheless, they choose Microsoft as a presentation, as far as I know. But while I agree with Vitalo that I believe they, the governments are not, I'm not sure if they're really following the rules. Great Britain is, for 2015, also the best.
So to my knowledge, there was a discussion, but there isn't.
No, UK, there is a law.
There's a law? Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. It's 22 July 2014.
Okay.
I was at the OSCON opening session. It was announced during that session.
Okay,
no one cared about it after that announcement.
I recommend that slide. Thank you very much for the feedback. And afterwards, I'll make sure I also update the Wikipedia article which talks about it.
But the fact that you don't find evidence is a confirmation of the fact that there's no real interest behind standards.
So I'll go into the next slide, and that's how to increase adaptation. And obviously that's the $1 million question, at least that's the term in the US, maybe Europe has a different phrasing of that sentence. But one of the questions is, who is actually responsible for that policy? Is it the government or ICT authority? Is it another agency inside the government? In some government there's different agencies or different ways to share the responsibility. Such a policy might come, let's say, from the Ministry of Education, because they have to deal with a lot of students or a lot of documents created for the educational process. It might be coming from Ministry of Health, because they have some of these issues, especially with medical records, and it might be coming from, I don't know, commerce, because a de facto standard might really affect how commerce is being done, or requirements or regulations. In some places it might come from antitrust agencies, because they want to talk about competition. The other question, sometimes it's not a policy that comes from the government itself, it might come from the parliament. And in some cases, it might be a committee regarding IT, a committee regarding science, each country has its own terms. And another question from our side, do we use lobbyists, do we use volunteers? Yesterday we had a talk over dinner about the use of lobbyists. Commercial companies use them all the time. Open source associations use them rarely. Sometimes because of how things are done in the open source world. Sometimes because of budgeting issues. And sometimes because our perspective to a lot of these issues is more technical than political. And it's a completely different point of view. There's a difference between proving to someone this is a better solution than actually making him to adopt it. And another thing about it is sometimes, or in a lot of times, we see stuff which are not the best technical solution get adopted because of political reasons. And there is probably a need for us to also learn that angle, and not only on the technical level. Because as we see in previous lectures, we're very technical and we refer to that and we try to beat the competition on that level, but not on other levels. In some cases, there are other institutions that might be relevant, like national archives, especially as they're the organizations which actually encountered the problem today, and for them it's a burning issue or very urgent. Because if you ask them for a document from 30 years ago, the probability they can actually give you the content of the file is today, I think, almost zero. Unless they have a printed version, they can scan, they can do OCR, or they save the computers with old version of the software. And I hate to see whatever governmental institution runs Word 6 on Windows 95 just to be able to open files. That sounds a little bit weird, but it might be the only option. Another thing which is mentioned a few times when you search about ODF is multinational organizations. One of the most famous search results about it, it's NATO, that requires ODF as a standard for all of its countries. And then you see the list of about around 20 countries, and you think, well, I died and reached heaven, it's perfect, half of Europe, some places in the Balkans or Eastern Europe. And then you understand there's no way to enforce this standard on the governments. So yes, there might be a few computers that has whatever software just for internal communication in NATO, or as Italian said, it might be not a policy which is enforced. But do these bodies anyway has the ability to enforce any policy, or is just a written letter which is actually a dead letter? We're about two-thirds of the presentation, and while writing the presentation, I had more questions than answers, because it's a different process in each country. In countries which are more technical, less technical, some countries have a better political figure behind the ICT authority, which might move things faster. But in the end, I was left with more questions than answers. And for that, I would be happy to hear your comments or your experience of how is it done in your countries. Because from next week, I'm actually going to do it in Israel. After writing an article for the newspaper about LibreOffice and open standards, trying to take advantage of the regulation of the deal between the government and Microsoft about Microsoft Office. And I'm trying to put, let's say, at least a wedge or a foot in the door in that wall, and there's a lot of knowledge to be shared between the countries. If anyone has any experience or knowledge of what has been done in his country, I'd be happy to use the rest of the time, which is about 10 minutes for that. So your ideas and experience, please. Yes.
The first point,
could you just say your name and where you're from, because the camera is on me, not on you.
Oh yeah, sure. Daniel, I'm from Sweden, work for the Swedish government. Mm-hmm. My experience doing this for quite many years is that most people, at least from in municipalities or healthcare or central government, they have no idea what a format is, they have no idea what the standard is, and they don't care. They conflict an application and a file. They have no way, it's like just a mix. I start Word and it says a Word thingy, mm-hmm. sort of. So going into having sort of the discussion of ODF and different forms is like, there's no one there, there's no one to talk to, right? We spoke to the National Archives, so I would say there's always no one home to talk to.
Because there are no technical people, because
they have no knowledge.
Okay.
And they just document, and if you come along with something else, here's your profits, you can open the document. And if it's something wrong with it, then it's your fault. It's not the format or the application who created the data.
Exactly.
It's always the receiver's fault. Mm-hmm. So what I'm sort of discussing right now, my view of it, is trying to, you have to go the route of like technical, I see LibreOffice online as a really the major deal breaker of getting in. Because if you're used to Microsoft Office installed on-prem, it works in a certain way. If you can come and say, hey, you can work it this way. You don't need on-prem stuff, and you can do collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, you get OEF. And they say, well, I don't care. I like this nice feature that I can do collaboration. The completion then is, of course, Office 365. But for a lot of governments, it's unlawful to use. They will realize, at least over time, they'll realize there's a lot of laws get broken if you're a European country of using Office 365 or Google as well, doesn't matter.
Yeah, whatever cloud services, but that's another issue. The question is, when they download the document from, it doesn't matter if it's LibreOffice Online or Office 365, and they want to edit it locally, which happens, the question, would it complain that it doesn't produce a Microsoft Word binary, or there's other issues. The other thing.
There's a bunch of issues.
Yeah. The other thing is that there's some kind of bias towards a lot of times, sometimes open source, sometimes just new software. That I found out that when someone have a feature or something doesn't work for him in Microsoft Office, it's like this. It's an act of God. Like, okay, it doesn't work. It's okay. Yeah. I understand that. Like, ask someone. But if it's a different program or open source, it's your fault. It's the program fault. Their deterrence for problems goes almost to zero. And that's one of the other issues we need to deal with. And that's regardless of the talk about open standards. Someone else? Thank you very much. So from my experience, it's very hard to combine between what, similar to what you said, there's nobody home regarding the technical level. And on the other side of the scale, it's the politics of it. Like, if there's a way to get a deal from a big company, they don't care what they actually get. So they don't check the details. They just, okay, we'll pay money, we'll get their solution, we don't check, we don't care. And sometimes the problem is the don't care part. If they check and decide this is better, and let's say they do it every few years, it's reasonable. We might not agree with the result, but it's reasonable because they did the check. But in most cases, they don't consider any alternative. I think in Europe, the situation is better because the language support is more native. In other countries, language support, let's say it's RTL, CGK, it's another issue or a barrier to leap over. This is one of the things I know I need to deal with, is that when I offer LibreOffice, they say, well, it doesn't support Hebrew. The actual response is, obviously it does, and it's actually very good. It's not perfect, but very good, but then we have other issues. Some issues might be how the program looks, which is totally different than ODF, but for that, we might have other solutions. If we, I don't know, find a way to work with Google on standardization, maybe we'll have a better chance because that levels the playing field for us and for them. Maybe governments will be willing to buy solutions which combine editing services on the cloud, leaving alone other privacy issues, and an offline solution from LibreOffice, and then trying to enjoy both worlds. Okay? Whenever LibreOffice Online is ready and good enough, let's do that. On the other thing, in some cases we need strong enough companies first to promote the standards and on the other hand promote the products. Because in a lot of cases, although we see some companies in the conference, their solution to governments is not necessarily very well known, or it's not a solution that everyone promotes. there's a difference between branded, by company branded solution, which is fine. We can talk with each of our sponsors for the conference for that. And having said that, LibreOffice Online as a community option is great, and then you can buy support from whatever. There's a big difference. And I think, at least from my experience with other things regarding open source, we need a big commercial company to do some of the heavy lifting. At least for Israel, we had a few issues with standards regarding websites and web development. There used to be two standards to display Hebrew in websites. I'm talking about mid-90s to early 2000s. And whenever enough companies changed, or some big company came, that was the big change. New browser brought a change. Google forced standardization that Firefox already had, but didn't have enough power to create. And that includes both Firefox and Opera. In other cases, a lot of things change into adaptation to mobile websites and alignment of standards. When people had iPhone in a different browser on their phone than what they had on their PC, because they use internet, let's say Internet Explorer, and it's crooked standards, and then suddenly they have a different web browser, and then companies understood they need to act differently. I think we might find a different solution towards that with cooperation with commercial companies. Italy, you had a comment?
No, it's core, so your time is over. Sorry.
Okay. So thank you very much. If you have other corrections or questions...
I didn't want to kill you, but...
That's okay. If you have any comments or correction to my slides, please contact me afterwards. I'll be happy to amend them before I upload. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
What do you do, set up and answer a question?
The slides which is just on my machine article already. Could you also provide the links to this mandatory use and maybe implement them in the PDF?
So most data here actually is the base is the wiki page, and with the comments I mentioned, the wiki page gets updated. I have also some research.
I have updated this wiki page pretty much on the German situation, and it has been subject to edit wars. So this is not necessary at last things, of course.
Okay, so you said I should also take the German version of the page?
Well, the German version of the page, especially I made some page to the OBS adoption in Germany 2 years ago, and there's not much left of what I presented.
Okay, but just to make sure I understand, the section about Germany in the English page, or you just edited the German article of the page?
I edited the English and the German ones.
Okay.
The warriors on the other side were also quite as effective.
Thank you very much. I wouldn't steal his more of his time.